Well, that was a different bell. I like that one. Is that the Christmas bell? Okay, we'll take that as the Christmas bell. Oh, friends, God is good. And all the time. And what a blessing to be here this morning. And oh, was that fun outside? I was joking with some people. I was saying this is the perfect kind of snow because it's cold enough to snow in the air, but it's not cold enough to stick on the ground, right? Until we get home and can get the sleds out, then later. That's what we want, right? Hopefully there's enough snow by the time we get home. But it's great to have you all with us this morning. Those of you who braved the elements to be here with us on this second Sunday of Advent, for those of you joining us from the safety and warmth of your homes, it is a blessing to have you with us as we gather this morning in worship on our second Sunday of There are two colors in Advent that are used. One is purple. The purple is the symbol of royalty, right? Christ the King coming to this earth. The other is blue. Traditionally, it's been... Wow. Maybe that's what the voice of God would sound like with the echo. You never know. The blue, for many, symbolizing the coming of a boy child. But blue is also... theologically, is the color of repentance. And it is a reminder that we cannot accept Christ as our Savior until we've come to the point of recognizing that we need a Savior. And so the two colors come together. And I figured, because you're a congregation that likes to use both colors, I'm just going to go back and forth. Because this is fun to do. Last thing, I've had some people that have remarked about this stole, and I've told you that I've had some missionary connections in Africa. This is a stole from Zambia. Zambian cloth that was used, and I was actually not, I wasn't the one who brought this back. My mother-in-law found this cloth and had this stole made for me. And I only get to pull it out at Advent, and only at churches that do Advent blue. So thank you for doing some blue and some purple this time. But it doesn't matter what colors that we are using to remind us of Advent. It is the season of Advent that is what is drawing us together and reminding us that at the beginning of the Christian calendar, we are in a very special time. Because when the Christ child came, everything changed for us. Amen? And it is with the recognition of all that has changed for us because of Christ in this world that we are called to worship together. So friends, as you are able, please stand for the call to worship. Can you imagine? The wolf lives with the lamb. The leopard rests with the goat. The Lord's light shines on a weary world, illuminating possibility, beckoning us to hope.
With peace in our hearts, let us worship God.
Speaking of the promise, come, oh come, Emmanuel. The light of glory filled the sky, and we heard the angel choir. Joy to the world, joy. To the world, the Lord has come.
Friends, I'll invite you to be seated as we invite Nona and Donald to come and lead us in the lighting of the Advent candle this morning. There's a red light.
Today, hi. Today we celebrate Christ coming to Bethlehem and is coming into our lives. We are here because God's promises to our ancestors came true when Jesus was born. There is no greater gift than love, and we await his return to glory. Today we light the candle of love. The manger in Bethlehem reminds us just how far God will go to say, "I love you." May that same love touch you and your loved ones this Advent season. Because God has filled our hearts to overflowing, we light the candle of love. A voice cries out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord." A choir sings in the silence, "Come, Emmanuel." Every valley shall be filled, every heart shall be made whole, for peace is stronger than turmoil, and love is louder than hate. Let us pray. Let us pray. God of love, how humbled we are that your Son left the glory of your presence to be born in a stable, cold and dark. We thank you that you still enter cold and dark places in our lives to bring the warmth and light of your love. Like this candle, cause us to shine your love into the dark world. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you. Well, friends, we invite you to stand again as you are able for our opening hymn that is in 166 in our green hymnals that are back out. Let all mortal flesh keep silence.
Please be seated. In this season, so many voices wish to claim our attention. our devotion, our time, and our dollars. But when we stand before the manager of the Christ child, we find there is only one voice that can claim our whole lives, soul, body, heart, and mind. In humility, let us now confess our faults to the one who proclaims our forgiveness. Cleansing God, we hear the call to repentance, but we struggle to respond. The voice tells us to turn around, but we prefer our own ways. Okay. You seek to purify us in love, but we constantly elude your searching hand. Our sin leads us in other directions, away from you, away from life. Look with mercy upon us. Clear a space within us so that something new might be born, something that might return us to the way you have shown us in Jesus Christ. Now a silent personal confession. Now our confession song. Into sin, God promised a Savior. The season of Christmas reminds us that God's promises are true. In Christ Jesus, we can trust in the transformational power of God's forgiveness and receive the greatest gifts of this Christmas season, the gifts of God's love. In Jesus Christ, we are now forgiven.
Thanks be to God. And friends, with forgiveness comes peace, a peace that we are instructed to share with one another. Friends, the peace of Christ be with you. We share the peace of Christ not only with those that are around us, but we also are reminded that we are a hybrid congregation. We have those worshiping with us online. So let us pass the peace of Christ with those online with us first. If you wouldn't mind standing. And you'll see the sign that's next to the wide-angle camera that's there. Let's wave and share the peace of Christ with those joining us online today. And then let's take a moment to share the peace of Christ with those that are with us here this morning. For those, if you're with people worshiping at home, feel free to share the peace of Christ amongst each other. If you find yourself worshiping alone on this Lord's Day, remember, you are not alone. The Spirit is always with us. Take a moment to share a word of thanks to the Lord for somebody special in your life.
Well, friends, now that we have all that forgiveness and all that peace in our hearts, we're going to do a new song. It's not new. It's about 7 years old, but it's called King of Heaven, and it's so catchy. I guarantee it, you're going to be humming it all the way home from church today. And you ready? It's real simple. Here we go.
Let your kingdom come here. Let your will be done here in us. Jesus, there's a throne greater. You alone are Savior. Show the world your love.
Here we go.
King of heaven,
seated. Let us now prepare our hearts and our minds to hear God's word as we pray. O Lord our God, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, that we may be obedient to your will and live always for your glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Today's reading is from Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 10, and you can find that on page 1076 in your Pew Bible. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hands into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. In that day, the root of Jesse will stand as the banner for the peoples. The nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, this morning we continue in our sermon series for Advent, discovering the heart of Advent. Now you'll notice that I'm not coming with my Bible. I'm not coming with notes. And that is because in ancient traditions, sometimes the Word of God came through story form. It was a tradition in the Middle East called Chaflat Samar. Chaflat Samar was the tradition in which there were authorized storytellers in every village, those that knew the stories of the people, those who knew the stories of the faith. And the people would gather typically a couple times a week, maybe more, into wherever the center point was in the village. And they would come to hear the stories of their faith, the stories of their people, the stories of their history. And these authorized storytellers would tell these stories. Sometimes it was in a town square. Sometimes it was under the tree. That was the gathering tree. Sometimes there were different places. But they would come to hear these stories. And the stories that were told, everybody knew the stories. And the stories that I'm going to tell today are not new. We hear them every single year for Advent. But instead of hearing it in sermon form, I wanted you to hear it as it would have been told through the oral tradition. Now, when we do storytelling through the tradition of Chaflat Samar, you don't do it word for word. So if you open your Bibles to Luke chapter 1 and you follow along, you'll notice that I'm covering pretty much everything that's going to be in Luke chapter 1, but I'm not doing it word for word. No, we're doing it concept by concept. And the storytellers would many times weave themes into it, and maybe even interludes, points of reflection. And so that's what we're going to be doing this day. This morning, as we are doing the heart of Advent, we've talked about the fact that we're discovering how to prepare ourselves for Christmas. And this morning, we're putting these puzzle pieces of Advent together, and the puzzle piece that we're picking up is the ear of Advent. That's why you'll see on that previous screen, heart is spelled a little funny with ear capitalized. What is the ear of Advent? Well, the ear of Advent is the angels speaking. Gabriel is going to come and visit both Zechariah and Mary, and we're going to be hearing both of those stories this Lord's Day. And it is actually the angel coming that is the precipice of this message today. But before we dive into the stories of Zechariah and Mary, we need to talk a little bit about angels. What are angels? We don't talk about this a whole lot in the Presbyterian Church, in the Reformed tradition. But angels are a critical component of the heavenly realm. Some people wonder, are angels just a reflection of God? Well, no. See, the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent, which means that God knows all. God is all-powerful, and God can be, the Holy Trinity can be anywhere, in any place, any time. Angels are not that way. Angels are created beings just like us, in the sense that they were created and they live within the confines of time and space. That's an interesting thought, isn't it? Angels can only go where they are instructed, and things can stop them from getting there. We see at the end of the book of Daniel that the Lord has sent a message to the prophet Daniel through an angel. The angel is delayed by days getting to Daniel because of a spiritual war that is happening, a battle that is happening, and that angel is literally, physically somehow, kept from getting the message to Daniel. We say, if angels are created beings, why can't we see them? Well, they exist in a different dimension, and that's another conversation for another time. But they live in a dimension beyond ours, but they are able to enter our dimension, and when they do, we can see them. They may look a little different, but they do seem to have a figure. They do seem to have a form that is human-like, but they are not physical beings. And Scripture tells us that angels can only go where they are instructed to go. Angels do not have free will like we do as human beings. They serve at the pleasure of the King of Kings, and they only do what God has commanded them to do. So with that in mind, we get into our first story of Zechariah. Now, Scripture says that Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth were godly people. They were upright. They were the pillars in their community, in their village. They were the people that people looked to and went, those are godly people. We love Zechariah and Elizabeth. We couldn't imagine having not having them in our community. The bonus was that Zechariah was a priest. He was from the line of Aaron, and Elizabeth actually was as well. This is a line that went back over 1,000 years. Now, if you were a male and you were part of the priestly line, then that meant that you got to serve in the temple. Now, there were enough priests that the people who served in the temple, the priests that served in the temple, didn't have to live in Jerusalem all the time. What they would do is they would travel from wherever they lived, and they would travel to Jerusalem, and they would serve for a period of time, for a week or more, and they would live in the barracks there, and then they would return home. And because of that, the priests were taken care of by the rest of the community. So these people were just absolutely beloved because they were like, we have a priest who lives in our community. Now, the village that Zechariah and Elizabeth were from was, it says it was a village just outside of Jerusalem, about 4 miles in the hill country of Judea. Traditionally, if you go there today, that village is known as En Kerem. It would take you by foot back in those days. It would take you about 2 to 4 hours to get to Jerusalem, depending on how much of a hurry you were in. You went uphill to Jerusalem, and you went downhill to go back home. So you got home a little faster than you got to Jerusalem. But there was one thing that really stood out about Zechariah and Elizabeth, these godly, godly people in their community. And that was the fact that they didn't have any children. Now, back then, having children was considered the greatest sign of blessing of God in your life. So to have these people who were godly, upstanding, upright people who have no children really caused a complex relationship. And people wondered, what's going on here? Because if you didn't have children, the assumption was God had judged you for something. And here they had no children. Now you can imagine that that was a prayer that was lifted up regularly by Zechariah and Elizabeth. Lord, please give us a child. But at some point, reality had set in. He was now much older in age. We get the sense that he might have been what we would call past retirement age. Now, as priests, you continued to serve as long as you were physically able to. And that's where we find Zechariah. Zechariah is back in Jerusalem, and he is doing his work in the temple. And at any particular time, there could be 100 or more priests that have come from their different areas to serve in their time in the temple, and they've got to take care of all of the temple duties and the cleaning of the temple and taking care of everything and helping with the sacrifices for the people who come in. But there's one really special job that every once in a while a priest got selected to do, and that was the offering of the incense and prayers of the people in the holy place. Now, the holy place in the temple was a place that was completely surrounded by curtains. Nobody could go in there except the priest that was selected on that day to bring incense, to hear the prayers of the people that were gathered in the temple that day, and then to bring those prayers into that sacred space along with incense that was pleasing to the Lord. Most priests never got to do it in their lifetimes. Why was this? Because the selection of the priest was completely done at random by the casting of lots. And whoever the lot fell to was the priest that was selected to do it on that day. Well, you can imagine when you've got 100 or more priests in a week, how many days in a week? You do this time and time again, you never know. But the reason that it was done by the casting of lots was because even though it's something that is random to us, they believe that God, who is the creator of all things, can work even through random things. If you go back to the story of Jonah, we see this played out. When Jonah was trying to run away from God and got on a boat to flee from going to Nineveh and got on a boat in Joppa to leave, God brought a storm on that ship, and the captain and the crew said, "This is supernatural. We're going to cast lots to figure out who's gotten God angry and who did the lot fall to." Jonah. Was that random? No. God caused that to happen. Well, on this day, the lot fell to Zechariah. Zechariah, in his old age, is now given the honor and the privilege of receiving the prayers of the people as they are gathered outside in the temple area. They give their prayers to Zechariah, the priest of the day. And then Zechariah takes all of those prayers, and then he walks into the holy place with the incense, and he goes to the altar in the holy place, and he offers the prayers to the Lord. And then when he is done, he steps out and offers a benediction back to the people. We can imagine the privilege of being able to do that on that day. So Zechariah gets in there. They tie the rope around him before he goes in. Why did they tie a rope around his waist? I'll tell you about that in a moment. And then he walks in. Now, every priest knows that when he walks into that space, it's him and God. That's it. There's no other physical presence in that room, in that space. So imagine the shock when Zechariah goes walking past the curtain into the holy place and realizes he's not alone. An angelic figure is standing next to the altar and greets Zechariah and says, "Your prayer has been heard from the Lord and will be answered." Zechariah's got to be going, "Wait, what prayer? I just got almost 100 prayers outside that I'm bringing in with me. None of them were mine. They're everybody else's. What prayer are you talking about?" The angel says, "Your wife will conceive and bear you a son. And you will name him John. And this child will be filled with the Holy Spirit before he is born. So no wine or fermented drink is to ever touch his lips." And if you know, that's the vow of the Nazarite, given to John before he's even born. And he will be filled with the spirit and the power of Elijah, the greatest of the prophets of Israel. Many will rejoice in his birth, and he will prepare the way of the Lord. Now imagine you're Zechariah. You are inside the holy place. The place where you've only dreamt of ever being able to walk into, knowing that the presence of God exists in this confine. An angel of the Lord is telling you that your prayer from long ago has now been answered. A prayer that maybe you stopped praying a decade or more ago. And you're being given an answer. In the most sacred of places, you're being given an answer from the Lord. How would you respond to hearing this? Zechariah, who was a pillar of faith in his community, in the most sacred of spaces and serving the King of Kings as a priest of Israel, falters in his faith. In that moment, doubt overtakes him. And he says, how can I know that what you are saying I can be certain of? Take a look at me. I'm an old man. Well, I feel like that some days. But Zechariah says, I'm an old man and my wife is well in years. And the angel answers him by giving him his name and his position. Now hold on to your hats and glasses, folks, because when in ancient culture, if somebody gave you their name and their title, they were sharing their power and authority. And you better hold on for what's coming next. The angel says, I am Gabriel. And I come from the presence of the Lord. Hold on, what does that mean? Well, where do we talk about when we go to prayer? I like to say, let us find ourselves before the throne of God in prayer, right? We believe that the God of creation sits on the throne of creation. If you are an angel coming from the presence of the Lord, that means you are a throne room angel. That means you are the angel that is posted next to the throne and you know everything about the business of the Holy Trinity. You know it all. God has sent the most trusted of angels from the throne room to bring you this news. Uh-oh. And he says, because you did not believe what I told you, you will not be able to speak from this moment on until all that I have said has come to fruition. And then Gabriel's gone. Zechariah finds himself in this very weird predicament. He's in the holy place. He still has a job to do. He has to offer the prayers of the people to God, and he can't talk. And he's in there for quite a while. The people are starting to wonder, what's going on? Why has he been in there so long? Is everything okay? Well, they tie a rope around the waists of the priests when they go into the presence of God, just in case something happens when they're in there and they need to pull them out. Every once in a while, if they're in there a little long, they might do a little tug. Are you okay in there? Tug back. Okay, yep, he's still there. Eventually, Zechariah does come out. And remember, when he comes out, what is he supposed to do? He's supposed to offer a benediction. And guess what he can't do? And everybody realizes in that moment that he has encountered the Lord in that space. Zechariah completes his service in the temple. He goes home to be with his wife. She conceives, and Zechariah goes into seclusion. Fast forward 6 months. We're going to leave the beautiful great city of Jerusalem. We're going to leave the temple, the place where God has chosen to reside in Old Testament times, and we are going to travel, not to a little village outside of Jerusalem. No, we're going to travel over the hills of Samaria, and we're going to go to a little village called Nazareth. Now, where is Nazareth? Well, imagine, this is the best I can offer. We're leaving the Portland area. We're leaving Hillsboro. We're going out towards Banks. We're going to cut a right towards Vernonia. And then we're going to go up a little known road to a town named Jewel that nobody has ever been to. Unless there's a reason to go there. That was Nazareth back then. Nazareth was the town that was so out of the way up in the hills, and you only went there if you had a purpose. Nobody important was there. Nothing significant happens there until the angel Gabriel shows up in Nazareth to a young virgin named Mary. Now, Mary was betrothed in marriage to Joseph of Bethlehem, the son of the lineage of David. Now, when a young woman, a virgin, is betrothed, they were typically somewhere around the age of 12 or 13, maybe 14 at most. And what happens is an arrangement is made. The bride-to-be may not even know her future husband, okay? That's how it worked back then. And they're kept separated. They might meet each other, but everything is made sure that nobody's getting anywhere close to each other, okay? And once the betrothal happens, which is the commitment between the groom or the groom's family and the bride's family, the groom then takes off to go and build a home for her, or for his new family and for his new bride. So he's gone. He's out of the picture, okay? And the wedding doesn't happen until his home is done and he comes back and says, now I'm ready. And then they figure out the wedding and it happens. So Mary has been betrothed, but her groom-to-be is long gone. He's off building and he's not around. And she's just doing her thing as a good daughter in her family. And Gabriel shows up and says, blessings to you, most favored one of the Lord. And Mary just about hits the ground in fear and trembling. Who are you and why are you here? And the angel Gabriel says, do not be afraid. The Lord is with you. You will bear a son. And you will name him Jesus, which means deliverer, Yeshua. And he will be called the Son of God, and he will sit on the throne of David. Now imagine Mary. Mary's got to be thinking to herself, okay, first of all, what are you doing here in Nazareth? We're in the middle of nowhere in this little village. And my family is a nothing family inside my village, and I am a young woman who has nothing. And you're coming to me and saying, I am favored with the Lord? But unlike that moment of Zechariah, where all of his life experience allowed doubt to creep in, she realizes the power of this moment and goes, the angel just said, this is happening. Not this is going to happen. This is happening in the present tense. You will bear a son. And she's thinking to herself, well, wait a second. I'm betrothed, but my husband's not here yet. Okay, we're not legally married. And so This is kind of physically impossible, so she's kind of caught up in the physical things as well with Zechariah. But she's also believing, she has this faith that this is happening. So she just asks for clarification, not doubt, but clarification to Gabriel. How is this supposed to happen since I'm a virgin and my husband's not anywhere around? And Gabriel says, the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you so that the child that you bear will be holy and will be the Son of God. And Mary in that moment realizes the power of that moment. God's promise that for generations they had talked about, the coming of the Messiah, was now about to happen, and God had chosen her. And in that moment, she says, I am the Lord's servant. Let it be done as you have said. And then Gabriel is gone. Friends, we know that God is always at work. But most of the time, God's not calling attention to that work unless it's something special. And when it's something special, God says, I want y'all to pay attention, okay? Sometimes that comes through angels. And this wasn't the first time that angels show up with birth announcements to Zechariah and to Mary. No, in fact, angels showed up with birth announcements for Isaac, for Ishmael, for Jacob, for Esau, for Samson. But when angels show up, we need to cue our ears to listen. Because when angels have an announcement to make of God at work, whether it's an ancient work or now, it is the reminder that God is still at work in our midst. And even though this story comes from 2,000 years ago, we will be continuing to look at how God is at work through some more stories, all the way through Christmas Day, and then when Carly comes to share with us stories of God at work now in the mission field. Friends, this is how we prepare for Christmas. This is how we find the heart of Advent, by tuning our ear to when God speaks to us, or through his angels, to say, here I am, I love you, and I am doing a good thing for you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you had a plan. You knew precisely when to bring your Son into this world and how it needed to be done. And then, Lord, we are reminded that you still have a plan. A plan that continues to bless us, that continues to bring the kingdom into our midst, and continues to share the power of the gospel in the world around us. May we find in this time of preparation of Advent and getting our hearts ready for Christmas, may we let your Spirit speak to us to open our eyes and our ears to where you are at work today in our lives and in the world around us. It is in your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. I'd like to invite the choir now to come and share with us a moment of worship.
Inspire each heart with illumined surprise and kindle a flame anew. Increase our faith and strengthen our lives. Show us the joy of living life in you.
How beautiful. Thank you, choir. Well, friends, we find ourselves now at the communion table during the season of Advent. And this is a meal that has been set up for us from the Lord. And you may ask, well, who gets to partake? Who gets to be a part of this meal? All of us. All that is required is faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And then this meal means something to us. And so we prepare our hearts now for receiving this meal as the family of God. Will you please join me before the throne of God in prayer? Let us pray. Gracious Lord, as your angel Gabriel shared the news with Mary, Gabriel also said, your cousin Elizabeth is now 6 months with child, for nothing is impossible with God. But Lord, we come to this communion table and we have to admit that there are times where we wonder what might be possible. We see our own failings and we wonder, is your grace really big enough? There are times when we feel forgotten and we wonder, do you truly love us? We see the brokenness in this world and we wonder, God, are you really at work? And then we hear your stories. And we are reminded that, yes, you are at work. But your timing is always perfect, even when it's not our timing. And so, Lord, as we come to this table here on this Advent Sunday, We pray that you will move our hearts in reminding us that with you all things are possible. And that with you, nothing happens outside of your will. So, Lord, we pray for your Spirit to be present on this bread and on this cup, on these elements, that they may be for us the broken body and blood of our Lord and Savior. And it is in that faith and in the gathering that we have together as the people of God that you have called as this church family that we pray the prayer your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts. Amen. On the night in which our Lord was betrayed, he took bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, Take and eat. This is my body that has been broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Then after the supper, he took the cup, the third cup of the Passover, and he said, This cup is the new covenant that is sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. We are reminded that every time that we take this bread and this cup, we are proclaiming our Lord's birth. Life, death, resurrection, and second coming, until the day comes in which our Lord will serve us this meal himself. For these are the gifts of God for the people of God. I'm going to invite Dana to come forward to help me with serving communion as I do. Just a word of instructions. First of all, for those of you who are joining us online, if you want to partake in communion with us, feel free. You can hit pause on your video and go and grab your elements and feel free to join us during communion. For the rest of us, what we'll do is when you are ready, we invite you to come down the center aisle to come. We'll place a piece of bread in your hand and then you can take a cup, take it back to your seat and enjoy in communion. We just encourage you to come and we'll come in on this side, and then if you can return via the side aisle and back to your seat, that'd be hugely beneficial. For those of you who are not able to make it forward, don't worry. We will come to you. So just remain seated, and then after we're done, Dana and I will come and serve you communion where you are at. Come as you are ready. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, thank you for the gift of this meal, a meal that is meant to nourish our souls and remind us of the work of your Spirit continuing in and through us. And we pray that you will revitalize us, reminding us of the work that you continue to do and that you called us to do in your name for the work of the kingdom here and around the world. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, friends, as we draw our service to a close, I want to bring to your attention some announcements. And if you want to go ahead and pull out your announcement page, now I got to put my glasses back on. And just a few that we want to highlight, there's many more things that are happening in the life of the church, and I'll leave this for your reading later. But just a few to bring to your attention. The first is we're continuing to update the directory. You've got your camera, Gail's got his camera, so if you need to see Gary, you can, and he'll gladly take your photo in the fellowship hall afterwards. The second is that we are needing help decorating the sanctuary, and we've got some poinsettias that are starting to show up, and if you'd like to bring some to help with that, that would be wonderful. Baby shower for Jesus, the coat drive that's going to be happening, just this is a reminder, this is an early reminder of that happening, so as you are out doing your shopping, if you want to grab a coat for the coat drive, that'll be happening on Epiphany Sunday, which will be the second Sunday in January, that would be greatly appreciated. And then also a reminder of our Advent special offering that is happening. With the Advent special offering is happening in, you can give one special offering. We have envelopes for that. But what's happening is that special offering is going to be broken up equally in four parts. First will be a part to benefit our church, and specifically the job that's going to be there is for helping purchase paint. For we need some interior paint here in the church. We got to take care of the house that the Lord has given to us. The second portion, the second quarter, is going to go to the Oregon Food Bank, and that will be especially important because the food banks get a lot of food right now, but then right after the new year, their donations drop off precipitously. And so we're going to be able to help bring them a cash donation in a time that tends to be one where they don't have as many resources. The next will be for our country, and we do that through our denomination, the PCUSA, with the Christmas Joy offering. So one quarter of the offering will go there. And the last quarter will be going to Carly Pond with the missionary work that she's doing. And, of course, we're going to get to hear from her here in a couple of weeks. So the benefit of the Advent special offering is that it gets to go four places at once for a special year-end gift. And just a reminder that we continue in this time of after the pandemic, that we don't pass the offering plate. We do have the offering box that is there on our way out. But for most of us, we've been giving online. Or as I like to joke, I don't carry cash or a check. So if you don't give me a QR code or a way to do it online, I can't give. And we appreciate that for those who have been giving regularly for our congregation through online banking and giving online. So... we have our closing, do you have a, that's okay. Let me do a quick offering prayer and then we're going to close with our hymn. Gracious Lord, thank you so much for the many blessings you have continued to give to us and the offerings that we give to you, not just now, but also throughout the week, are just a reminder of how much you have blessed us and how we want to be able to bless you back through our church and through our offerings. May you take these offerings and bless them to your glory. In your name we pray, amen. Well, friends, we return to the green hymnal once again. Hymn 169, O come, Emmanuel. We close our service as we will each Sunday in Advent, looking forward in anticipation. The cross reminding us of the coming of the Christ child, the plan of grace already in action. And as we come anticipating the work of Christ in the birth of his son, or the birth of the Son on Christmas Day, let us receive this benediction. May the coming child king go with us, before us to show us the way, behind us to encourage us, beside us to befriend us, above us to watch over us, within us to bring us peace, both this day and throughout the Advent season. All God's people said, amen. Go in peace. Thank you.